Okay, good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2024. For those of you that were following our agendas for this week, we should have been doing the stage two of the Circular Economy Bill, but that's been postponed and will take place hopefully next week. Agenda item one is the decision on taking business in private. Agenda item one, consideration of whether to take item five in private. Item five is to discuss our work programme. Are we agreed to take this in private?
Item four.
Sorry, my mistake. I don't know why I said item five because it was there, but it should be item four for those of you that are eagle-eyed. So do we agree to take item four in private? We are agreed, thank you. The second item on the agenda is the consideration of a draft statutory instrument, the Transport Partnerships Transfer of Functions Scotland Order 2024. For this session, I'm very pleased to welcome Jim Fairley, the Minister for Agriculture and Connectivity. And Minister, you're joined by your team, who is Bridget Bryden, who's the Bus Regulatory Policy Team Leader, Transport Scotland. Kevin Gibson, who is a lawyer for the Scottish Government, and Bettina Seisland, who is the Director of Bus Accessibility and Active Travel from Transport Scotland. I hope I've got that right. Thank you for joining us today. The instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means it cannot come into force unless the Parliament approves it. Following the evidence session, the committee will then be invited to consider a motion to recommend the instrument be approved. Just remind everyone that officials obviously can speak under this item, but not in the debate that follows. Minister, would you like to make a brief opening statement?
Good morning, and thank you very much for having me to their meeting this morning. The Transport Scotland Act 2019 was designed to help make Scotland's transport network cleaner, smarter and more accessible than ever before. For bus specifically, it provides an enhanced suite of flexible options for local transport authorities to improve services according to their local needs and to ensure that they are sustainable bus networks right across Scotland. The 2019 Act amended the Transport Scotland Act of 2001 by substituting existing powers which allowed local transport authorities to put in place schemes for quality partnerships and quality contracts, with the new powers allowing them to establish bus service improvement partnerships and franchising frameworks respectively. It also provided local transport authorities with a new power to run their own bus services, which sit alongside their existing ability to subsidise services. Now, these powers are now available to those local transport authorities as defined in the 2001 Act, namely all Scottish local authorities and the Strathclyde Passenger Transport Authority, a precursor to the current Strathclyde Partnership for Transport, or SPT. In 2005, the Regional Transport Partnerships, or RTPs, were formed. Of the seven RTPs in Scotland, three took on additional powers in relation to bus services by means of transfer orders, similar to the one that is being considered today. And these so-called Model 3 RTPs are Southwest of Scotland Transport Partnership, or SWESTrans, the Shetland Transport Partnership, or ZTrans, and SPT in its current form. And I love Traffic Scotland's use of acronyms. The transferred bus powers include the ability to form quality partnerships and quality contract functions that have now been repealed and can no longer be used by the RTPs. In order for the RTPs to be able to use the replacement functions in the amended 2001 Act, as well as the new power to run their own services, an order under Section 10 of the Transport Scotland 2005 Act to transfer those functions is required. And it's always been the Government's intention that the effective RTPs would be able to access the full suite of bus powers provided for by the amended 2001 Act. And as such, the 2019 Act was drafted with the intention of laying this order following the commencement of the relevant powers. In preparing this order, the Government have engaged with the three affected RTPs as well as consulting with their constituent authorities, and all of the responses received were supportive of their proposals. This order will ensure the continuity of the powers for SWESTrans, ZTrans and SPT, allowing them to exercise these to improve bus services in their regions. And I will be happy to take any questions if you have them.
Thank you very much, Minister. And I'm sorry that we were slightly slow in getting you in. I think we'd programmed it in for 9:15. But I have to say, There was some confusion as far as the policy notes are concerned regarding the instrument. Now, the committee in the past has made comment about policy notes and how easy they are to understand and how helpful they are to the legislation. And the problem was that in all the explanation that we got, and I reread it several times again last night, couldn't identify what a quality partnership or a quality contract was. Do you think that might be made a bit clearer in the policy notes? It's a gentle nudge, Minister, for you to think about.
Yeah, I'm going to let Bridget answer that. We've had a similar conversation.
I was the one who drafted that policy note, so yes, I will take that point on board. Would you like me to explain the differences now?
I think we've had an explanation from Spice this morning, which was why we were slightly slow in getting to you. And it's really just a reminder that I know it's very easy for you as a group to talk about these things, because I'm sure that is what is the focus of much of your attention. However, from a committee's point of view, who have no knowledge of either of those, and certainly, you know, I was convener when we did the 2019 Act, and I was still scratching my head on what they were. It would have been helpful to have further things. I will labour the point no more. I've made it, and I think the Minister's noted it. So are there any questions from the committee on either of these? I've got Monica, followed by Mark.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister, and your officials. That's been a helpful opening statement, and thank you for the clarification. I know the information about powers, both existing and what this instrument will do. I wonder, Minister, if you can take the opportunity to explain if there will be more funding made available to transport authorities, because having the powers is really important, but we know there are big challenges around bus services right across Scotland, but I'm particularly thinking about the Strathclyde area, where many of my constituents are. And, you know, there's the power to run bus services and the existing powers to subsidise services, but when you speak to the authorities, they say they don't have the budget to do that. So what can be expected, do you think, in the months and years ahead?
Well, I can't say anything about funding at the moment. As you know, the funding is extremely tight. But what I do know is that transport is one of the huge sources of funding that goes out to the Scottish Government every year. Scottish Government budget for 24-25 allocated £5 million capital and £1 million resource for community the bus funds. There's all sorts of funding getting put into local authority buses or into the bus system right across the country. But I can't give you any more detail. We can tell you what's being done at the moment, but I certainly can't tell you anything about what's coming in the future.
Okay, fair enough. And I'm sure this committee will try our best to help you to persuade other colleagues that the investment in bus services is absolutely crucial to Scotland's economy, but also to achieving net zero. In terms of the consultation that Strathclyde Passenger Transport is currently consulting on around its approach to bus transport, we know that that includes potentially setting up a municipal bus company. Is this an approach that ministers would support?
First of all, I'll say that the government is absolutely cognisant of how important bus services are. It is the biggest source of public transport that we have, so you know, be no doubt about our commitment to that. In terms of what the local authority or the SPT do, that's their decision. It's entirely up to them how they go about what they're going to do. As long as they've looked at all their modelling, it's their choice.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Monica. I've got Mark, followed by Douglas.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Morning to the panel. I'm just trying to get a sense of where the government's vision is now for bus. So, as Monica Lennon has just outlined, we can have municipally run services, run in the public interest, owned by the public. We can have franchising, where regional transport partnerships, councils can actually control the provision of services within their areas. Or we can have the status quo with bus service improvement partnerships, trying to get fragmented services, fragmented public sector delivery, working a little bit better. What is the government's vision? Which of those three do you think is the way forward? Which do you back?
I think the government's vision is that we get as many people onto public transport as we possibly can by whatever means necessary. There are various options that local authorities and local transport partnerships can use, and it will be up to their local decision making, with encouragement from the government to do as much as they possibly can. There are some statutory obligations for each local authority to deal with, but by and large, those decisions and how they actually achieve it is entirely up to them.
Which option of those three options do you think will get more people onto public transport and repair services?
I can't give you an answer to that off the top of my head.
Okay.
I think, these transport powers, as the Minister says, it's very much about the local authorities and RTPs making their own decision about what's appropriate for their area. Where we do set out a vision is in the Fair Fares Review, which was published in March, and that is to make public transport affordable, available and accessible.
Which concerned pricing with the Fair Fares Review, really, rather than delivery model, which didn't cover it at all. Can I move on then to the announcement from the Cabinet Secretary a couple of weeks ago on climate, where as part of a package to try and reboot our action towards climate change, integrated ticketing was announced, a national programme of integrated ticketing, which of course has been announced previously 12 years ago, hasn't been delivered yet. It's clear that that will need to be delivered probably on a regional basis, rolled out across Scotland. So out of the three transport partnerships that are mentioned in the statutory instrument, which of these are going to be the first pilot areas to integrate ticketing in their areas and to encourage people, as you said, Minister, onto public transport?
I'll have to defer to officials on that one because I haven't taken that bit forward.
Mm-hmm.
So that announcement was made as part of the Fair Fares Review, and it's work that we're looking at. We haven't started those detailed discussions yet with local authorities and operators that might be interested in taking up a pilot. So that's work that we will need to do.
The regional transport partnerships that are mentioned in the statutory instrument, there's no understanding about whether they will move towards rolling out integrated ticketing in the near future. Is that correct?
So the intention is that we will look at delivery and look at a national integrated ticketing system for Scotland. But we will need to work with them to see what's appropriate in their area.
What would be the timescales for that?
We don't have the timescale set up because we've got NSTAB set up that are looking at the technological standards, and they're already set up to look at that, but they've got 3 years to provide recommendations on the appropriate technological standard.
Okay, so that would be 15 years then since the initial policy commitment to roll out integrated ticketing, and there's no understanding about whether these three regional transport partnerships that are mentioned here today will have any role within that in the near future.
So to deliver a national integrated ticketing system, all sort of the local transport authorities, including the three RTPs, will need to have a role in defining that. And the RTPs are represented on NSTAB, and NSTAB is the board that's been set up through legislation to look at smart and integrated ticketing. So they're already represented there.
My understanding is that there is an element of integrated ticketing already in Shetland, and Shetland is mentioned in this SI. So would it not be possible to move fully towards integrated ticketing within Shetland at least, and to support that delivery through a regional rollout?
A number of examples across Scotland of integrated ticketing systems and approaches that already exist, and NSTAB are looking at those to see what might be appropriate in terms of further development.
Okay.
Just help me, because I was listening to that question. The three councils that are mentioned, we've got the Shetland Islands Council, Dumfries and Galloway Council, and the Strathclyde Passenger Transport Authority. They all asked for these powers, is that right? They came to you, or did you just tell them you were giving them? Sorry, Bridget, it's you.
Yeah. So the three affected regional transport partnerships, when the regional transport partnerships were set up in 2005, at that point there was a consultation and it was determined, I honestly can't tell you if it was sought by the RTPs or if it was developed for some other way, it was determined that they should lead on bus powers in their areas. when we were developing the 2019 Act, it was always with the intention that they would continue to have the new bus powers. So there have obviously been discussions with them. We also had a formal consultation, which is required under the 2005 Act, where the... I honestly can't remember if it was the Minister at the time or the Cabinet Secretary at the time who wrote to them and formally consulted them and all of their local authorities.
Came back and said, yes, we want these powers, we're cracking our head, and we accept your business impact assessment that there's no cost involved in it, so that they can get on with it.
So the business, they all came back and accepted the powers. The business impact assessment, there was no business impact assessment associated with these regulations. There was one for the Act as a whole when it was written back in 2019, whenever the Act was laid, 2017.
So, but the comment in your policy note is that there is no business and regulatory impact assessment necessary, as the instrument has no financial effects on the Scottish Government, local government or businesses. So they're going to take on powers which have no cost.
So there is no cost to the local authorities in holding these powers. There will be a cost if they choose to use them.
Oh.
In the same way that there is a cost if they choose to subsidise services at the moment.
Okay. So what I'm taking from this is if they exercise the powers, they're going to need money. But that hasn't been discussed, and I'm not clear in my own mind if they ask for the powers or just being given them.
So we wrote to them and asked them if they were content to have the powers transferred, and they agreed.
Okay, thank you. Sorry, Douglas, I jumped the gun, I think, in front of you. I apologise.
No, not at all, Convener. I'm just going to follow on from that. We heard earlier, Minister, that there are seven regional transport partnerships. But, you know, this order is only looking at three of them. Is there a reason why the other, and it's probably a daft laddie question, is there a reason why the other four are not within this order?
So again, going back to 2005, when the transport partnerships were established, only these three sought to have the bus powers or wished to take on the bus powers at that time. So we, in carrying out this transfer order, we're not looking at changing the governance approach to regional transport partnerships in Scotland. There was a commitment to review that coming out of the Fair Fares review, which may mean that RTPs in future wish to take on further powers. What we're looking to do here is just ensure that the RTPs that had access to the older bus powers are also able to access the new bus powers. We don't want to be in a situation where we've taken powers away from them and not given them an alternative.
Okay. But Minister, would it not be better just dealing with all seven so they can have the powers if they're requested in the future? Maybe.
Well, the three that you've spoken to are the ones who have said that they want it. The others don't. That's my understanding of it.
And the Transport Governance Review will obviously be engaging with them, okay, and determining whether there needs to be any changes in future.
Okay, move on to my next question. In terms of the Quality Partnerships, Minister, we've heard in our sort of pre-brief that they're not formalised in any way. Do you think that's a good thing? Do you think they should be more formal in the way that they operate?
I want to defer to Bridget.
So Quality Partnerships no longer exist. There was, I think, five that were established in Scotland formally. Bus Service Improvement Partnerships, the new partnership powers, there is a very formal approach that has to be taken. And I'm sorry for the term partnerships, but there are already a number of voluntary partnerships in Scotland that may wish to move to becoming a formal Bus Service Improvement Partnership. But no one has commenced that process yet.
So when it's voluntary, that's when it's not formalised.
That's when it's not formalised.
Okay.
And when you're using the Bus Service Improvement Partnership powers, that's when you go through the sort of the process of reaching a legal agreement between the local authority and the operator.
Right, okay. I understand on that now. Minister, in terms of this order today, do we need this to pass to actually for some of the regions to move to a franchising model, or is that separate from this order?
They need these powers in order to progress anything that they want to do.
Because in terms of franchising?
Yes. In terms of, it's not just franchising, it's for
franchising,
any of
franchising partnerships, local authority,
yeah,
and services.
They need these powers to do any of the things that they would want to do.
Okay. And Minister, in answer to Monica Lennon's question earlier about how we get more people onto public transport, you said by whatever means possible, I think you said. So what will that mean to car users in the future?
Well, I think the government has a commitment to try to get our car usage down by 20% or 20 kilometres. Correct me if I'm wrong.
20%.
20%. So that's what we are aiming towards in order to try and help us meet our net zero targets. So we want to get people into buses, into trains, and into public transport.
And is that carrot or stick or a bit of both?
At the moment, it's all carrot because we're giving under 22s free concessionary travel. We're giving older and disabled people concessionary travel. Their local authorities have the ability to place car park charges, etc. So I think it's going to have to probably be a bit of both, but everything that I've seen up to now has been more carrot than stick, if you want to use that phrase.
But I guess if we sort of move into the sort of stick, I guess we have to recognise that in terms of some of our rural communities, you know, the car is still going to be very important to them, and we have to make sure that those communities are not penalised by anything that's done.
I would absolutely accept that.
With respect, we are straying a wee bit away from where the statutory instrument is. Although this line of questioning is interesting, I'm not sure it's following completely the line of the statutory instrument. So I'm happy to let you ask another question, and on actually specifically on this instrument would be helpful.
I'll leave it there then, Gavina.
Thank you very much, Douglas. Anyone else? Bob, sorry, you were next.
Thanks, Gavina. I think you set a very generous definition of wee bit there, Gavina, to be honest with you. Looking at the powers contained within this instrument, we've got BSIP, we've got franchising, and we've got your municipal bus company. It's an enabling powers. So it's not a directive for SPT, which would be my area, or others to use these, as enabling powers allowed to plan ahead for the future. Could the Minister clarify that, you know, a region as big that SPT covers, this is not an either-or. There's a world we live in where a bus service improvement partnership could be developed for one part of the SPT area. A business case for franchising, as is currently been put forward by SPT, can be developed. That would take several years, I understand, and significantly costly. And local authorities and SPT could dip their toe in the water in relation to running municipal services. So this is not a polar choice between one of three options. It's a mix and match at a localised level to best meet the needs of strategic transport and buses.
Agreed.
I think that's helpful because sometimes it feels it's an either-or. I think my colleague Monica Lennon was quite right to raise finances. And we know that if SPT were to use franchising powers, the costs would be eye-watering. And there's no point in anyone around this table, across any party, pretending that that spare change that government's got sitting about its coffers, because it simply doesn't. So can you say a little bit more about the conversation that government, the Scottish, would expect to have with other parties in this place about how to identify such funds that simply don't exist just now, but also any current or future government at Westminster, because if we're serious about our net zero aspirations, that takes partnership working across party and across government, and it needs to be financed. So can the Minister set out his thoughts about how we have those constructive conversations across party and across government?
I have to say, the Cabinet Secretary, my immediate boss, Fiona Hislop, when she had the debate for the Fair Share Review, what she did was she asked for a debate without motion, which I think Mark Ruskell, Alec Rowley and Graham Simpson all agreed to. And I think that was probably one of the most constructive debates that we've had in the Parliament since I've been a member. That is what I would like to see us continue doing. I think you're right to raise the cost of anything that we're going to do will require funding. It's going to have to be across the governments, because there is no way that the Scottish Government are going to be able to manage to do all the things that we would like to do, given the budgetary constraints that we have. But I absolutely take on board the point that you're making, that it will take cross-party conversations, and it's going to take a great deal of cooperation in order to achieve the big-ticket stuff, which is reducing our emissions.
I think that's helpful, Minister. I don't think that's an admission. I think that's just a reality of the world we live in, across party, but also across government as well. My colleagues also spoke about the Fair Fares Review, and I think, was it Bettina that mentioned that as well, one of your officials? Now, I also spoke in that debate without motion, convener, which I thought was an excellent way of trying to find where the Parliament is, so we're not boxed in by by party positions. And I made the point during that debate that in Glasgow or in Strathclyde, there's already a degree of integration there. The old zone card still exists, for example. There is multi-company bus tickets that exist. There's a variety of platforms there. And I made the case that Glasgow would be very well placed to be part of an integrated ticketing pilot, but also a flat fare pilot that's also been considered and that should integrate both bus and rail.
I think Mr. Norris is in danger of doing exactly what Mr. Lumsden
is doing. What I am doing, though, convener, is...
You're straying. As I thought when Douglas was going on, he was on a slightly different runway. I fear you may be going on to that same runway. I'll ask you to put a question.
I'll come to my question. I would just note, convener, that other colleagues have already asked very specific questions about the Fair Fares Review and integrated ticketing pilots. All I'm doing is asking the same, a similar question that colleagues have already asked who are not told they were straying from the point, and I think that's important. Can you tell me what your timeline is for identifying areas that may be considered for a pilot? How would members, Monica, myself, Mark, know that their area has been actively considered so we can get involved in that and support any bids or pilots that may be in the pipeline?
Well, I'll refer to Bettina on that as well.
Yeah, we don't have a timeline for it yet. So that recommendation and commitment was made through the Fair Fares Review, and now it's work that we need to do. And as you'd appreciate, we need to have proper discussions with the local transport authorities. We need to have the discussions with the operators, and through that, come up with an assessment of the options that might be appropriate so that ministers can consider that. And then once we've done the work, then we can set out the timeline.
And at that point, will members be informed? Or is there a timeline for when you're likely to have a timeline? In other words, can you tell us that by in 6 months' time, you can clarify what that timeline will look like, for example?
Well, I think you push that as far as you can. maybe it's a hanging question.
Let's say it's rhetorical, convener.
it was a nice try. Monica, I think you had a follow-up question.
Thank you, convener. Yeah, I was feeling inspired listening to my colleague, Bob Doris. I just wondered, given... there are real challenges around public finances, and we know that this investment is crucial, but being able to unlock that investment is not easy. Are you, Minister, and your colleagues having discussions with colleagues elsewhere? You know, it's not just about what we talk about here in Parliament. For example, can we learn from what's happening in Greater Manchester, the work that's been led by Andy Burnham? But because of lots of campaigning and lots of cross-party working, is that something that you're building into your fact-finding?
As far as I'm aware, and Bettina will correct me if I'm wrong, the Cabinet Secretary has been looking right across the UK at different models in order to try and work out what is the best way forward. Correct? Is that correct, Bettina?
Yeah, and I think, you know, we've had, as officials, we've had discussions with, colleagues that are sort of developing other models, including Manchester, to learn from them. And I think, you know, as we progress with this work, we'll need to sort of visit them and, you know, sort of like understand in more detail. So we'll develop that work programme.
That's encouraging. Thank you, convener.
Good. Thank you, Monica. I think we were in danger of going quite down a different rabbit hole, which we will have the questions we'll have to ask later. So. Well, I'm not sure this committee is going to visit Manchester, but there we go. Mark, I'll let you have a final question very much on the subject of this SR, please.
Okay, I'll try and keep it to the subject of it then. I mean, the three RTPs that are within the SI here, I mean, have they benefited from the Community Bus Fund? Because I think you mentioned earlier on, Minister, it's a relatively small amount of money, £5 million, but I think you'll have noticed in Perth and Kinross that the council has used it successfully to try and develop a new model of rural bus services that involve communities themselves in running their own services. So I'm just interested in where that kind of sits within a new emerging model of rural services, and whether these RTPs are using the Community Bus Fund. There's an expectation that Community Bus Fund will be enhanced, developed further in order to develop new models of delivery.
Tell you what these individual RTPs have done or what funding they have had. I don't know if Bridget or Bettina has got those figures to hand. If they would be useful to you, we can have them sent over to the committee.
So last year there was, I think, 10 different bids for the Community Bus Fund that were taken forward. They were available to RTPs across Scotland as well as local authorities. I can't tell you how much went to individual RTPs. We can write to you
I've
on that.
So SPT were awarded grant funding of £155,000 from the CBF to consider rural transport provision, local authority-run services and scoping of data provision. And they've used that information to feed into the Strathclyde Regional Bus Strategy.
Okay. And the two other ones that are mentioned in the SI, South West and Shand.
Don't have that information to hand, so we'll have to write that
to
you.
Useful.
Happy to have that information sent on to the committee clerks after the meeting. If there's no other questions, I'm looking around the room. No. Good. We'll move on to agenda item three, which is the debate on the motion for the committee to recommend approval of the draft Transport Partnership Transfer of Functions Scotland Order 2020. I'm going to invite you, Minister, to speak to the motion and move it. So over to you.
I've said all I'm going to say on the motion and moved.
So you're moving the motion. So the question is there anyone who wants to say anything? I don't mean to frighten everyone off. I mean, if there are members of the committee, can I just say that I understand it now. I've struggled to come to terms slightly with it, if I'm honest. And my slight concern is I'm not entirely clear that this is a voluntary take on by the three councils or two councils and the statutory transport partnership. Sorry, Strathclyde Partnership Transport, but in the principle of what we're trying to achieve, I think it would be wrong to vote against this, in my opinion. But I would seek more clarity in future when we come. And so I don't know if any other members have got any other comments that they would like to make. So, Minister, is there anything you'd like to respond to what you've just heard? The debate was me, so you could respond to me, or you could just say that you're happy and take away the points that have been made.
Content to move on, and points noted, Convener.
Thank you. So the question, therefore, we come to is motion S6M12678 in the name of Jim Fairley be approved. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you. The committee will report on the outcome of this instrument in due course, and I would invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to finalise the report for publication. Are you all happy? I'm seeing nodding heads. Thank you, and thank you, Minister, and your officials for attending today. That concludes our public part of today's meeting, and we're now going to move into private session. So, thank you.